Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Chicken Who Saved Us, The Remarkable Story of Andrew and Frightful by Kristin Jarvis Adams, narrated by Teri Schnaubelt. An animal's eyes have the power to speak a great language. Martin Buber. Prologue. Sue walked into a scene right out of a nightmare. Vomit covered the walls, soaked the bed, and was dripping onto the floor as fast as the IV pump could push formula through the feeding tube. I was shouting, Andrew was gagging, and the dogs were fighting in the hallway. "Please stay down, Andrew," I begged, pushing my 16-year-old son back onto the bed. Having thrown up with such force, the bottom end of the feeding tube had come out of his stomach and now hung from his mouth. The other end was still threaded through his nose and taped to his face, where it attached to the pump. I detached that end from the pump and went about trying to peel the tape off his face. He jerked, grabbing for my hand. "Please," I asked softly this time, tucking him in between two dry towels and aiming the fan directly at his hot skin. He had taken all his clothes off in an attempt to get cool and escape from the fever that burned in him day and night. His usual lean body had become anorexic, bony and dry, and his skin sagged on wasting muscles. Sue stood in the corner while I picked at the tape again. Andrew exploded off the bed. "I have to get up now. I'm gonna be sick." Sue reached for him and led him to the bathroom where he lay on the cold tile naked. Deep, guttural moans ricocheted off the bathroom walls, ripping me to my core. We'd been doing this for months, for years, actually, and it was only getting worse. I wondered how much a person could take before they said, "That's it, I quit." Andrew screamed again, and I heard a splash on the tile. Sue waved an arm in my direction. "I can handle this. I want you to leave, take the dogs for a walk, and don't come back for a while." I obeyed without protest, barreling out the door with two jacked-up dogs at my heels. I would get as far from the house as I could, far enough away that even if I had bionic ears, there would be no way I could hear the sounds of pain coming from my home. I clipped a leash to each dog and took off at a dead run, down the block and to the next, until I couldn't breathe and my own pain felt like ecstasy. An hour later, I came back, tear-streaked and sweaty, ready to walk back into my life. I didn't know what to expect when I opened the door, but I didn't expect this. Sue was sitting quietly on a low-slung IKEA chair next to Andrew. The rumble of laundry in the next room was music to my fried brain. Andrew had passed out on the downstairs playroom floor on a makeshift bed. Figuring it was the only place in the house cool enough to survive the July heat, John and I had fashioned a bed out of sofa cushions and sleeping bags, topped with an old foam bunk bed mattress, which we shoved next to a north-facing window. I noticed Andrew's feeding tube had been removed and his face was washed. Sue was praying, or what I took to be praying, because her eyes were closed and her lips moved as if she were having a secret conversation. She told me once she prayed for Andrew, prayed for mercy, grace, and healing for this boy she'd grown to love. Conversing with God wasn't new to her, but this level of misery was, and it pained her in a way that broke her heart. Andrew stirred and opened one eye. "Should we read a new book now, Andrew?" Sue asked, leaning forward to pull a thin cotton blanket over his legs. Andrew didn't respond, but she could see his eyes were open now, unblinking, staring out the window. She sat quietly and waited. The day Sue arrived as our respite care provider, Andrew's pain had been so intense that he could barely speak above a whisper. When she asked what he liked to do, he'd replied, "I like hero stories." So she began to tell him made-up stories using characters from old Judy Blume books she found in Andrew's closet. But her stories weren't regular stories. These stories included superheroes Andrew had fashioned in his own mind. These stories transported him to an imaginary world where he could escape the nightmare that had become his life. And Sue was the one who took him there, to the only place he felt safe. After a moment, Andrew raised a quivering hand in which he clutched a mini Sega action figure named Shadow. "Okay, let's put Shadow in this book instead," Sue said. She settled back into her chair and opened Judy Bloom's Super Fudge to the place where Fudge was teaching his minor bird, Uncle Feather, to talk. "This reminds me a little of you in Frightful, right, Andrew?" she asked. Andrew nodded, then sighed and kicked the blanket off his legs. Moments later, he began the slow grind of pedaling his feet up and down the mattress against the pane. Sue placed a hand across his thin, wiry legs. "Be still, my friend. What are Shadow and Fudge doing? Describe it to me." Andrew remained still, but made no effort to talk. Outside, a brood of hens scratched at John's newly planted flower beds, sending showers of fresh mulch across the walkway. A small bronze and black colored hen hopped up on a broken flower pot that had been pushed against the window. "Tick, tick. I am here," Andrew groaned and rubbed at his chapped and swollen face. At 16, he was tall, nearly 5'10", but he weighed little more than 100 pounds. For months, sudden fevers, pain, and nausea had become constant companions that we battled with a combination of anti-emetics, narcotics, Advil, and Tylenol. During the night, another fever had fingered its way up his body, leaving his skin dry and splotchy, and bathing his cheeks and lips in deep crimson. Even his usual shimmery red hair seemed faded and dull, plastered to his face in salty clumps. "Tick, tick, tap. Look at me." Frightful, the bronze-colored hen, pressed her body next to the window and turned her head to the side, regarding Andrew with one yellow raptor eye. Although she was a petite hen, she queened over the others, puffing her feathers to appear larger while throwing back her head in a loud squawk if any hen dared to challenge her. She reminded me of the red-tailed hawks we frequently saw circling the tops of the evergreens in our yard, and she had an attitude to match. A low rumble came from Frightful's chest as she rocked from foot before mashing her chest to the windowpane. "Tap, tap, tap. Gack! Look at me. Now!" Andrew turned to face the window. With a slender white finger, he circled the chicken's gold, caramel, and black feathers, tracing the areas where the little hen had left a trail of chicken snot in her attempt to get his attention. He pressed the dirty pane with the pad of his pointer finger, saying, "I hear you, Frightful." The chicken backed off, shook violently, and settled her feathers back into place. She made an elaborate show of easing her body down on top of the broken flower pot, where she perched while never breaking eye contact with her best friend. "I'm here, Frightful," Andrew repeated again before falling back into sleep. While Sue read her newly formed story starring Fudge and Shadow, I crept down the hallway into John's office and crawled under the desk. A litany of horrors tackled me as I thought about what was happening to our lives. Would we survive? How many blows could a person take before they curled up and died, I wondered. Although Sue came for a few hours each day to provide me respite, the truth was I was almost always too scared to leave the house. Fear had pinned me to the floor. Sue's gentle voice broke into my thoughts. "I'm leaving now, Andrew. I'll see you in the morning. Think about what we should read next. Maybe some Harry Potter?" I listened as she gathered her things, dreading the hours I would be alone with Andrew until John came home from work. When I heard her footsteps in the hallway, I ventured out of my cave only to knock my head on the corner of John's desk. I waited for her to leave before taking her spot in the chair next to Andrew, where I stared at my son for a long time, feeling terrified and helpless. Flipping through a stack of books on the windowsill, I wondered how Sue did it. What magic did she have that drew Andrew back from wherever he was? She even seemed to take away his pain, or at least make him forget about it for a little while. I thought about all the specialists John and I had taken him to over the years, and still we had no answers. Our son was desperately ill. Besides Sue, his only friend on this earth was a chicken named Frightful. As I sat there for what felt like eternity, Frightful continued her flower pot vigil. She occasionally flicked a beady bird eye in my direction as if to say, "Do something!" Crawling onto the floor, I squeezed next to Andrew's frail body on the little twin bed, my desperate attempt to protect him from the darkness creeping into the room. He was dead still, his breath barely a whisper on my bare arm. A sudden wave of anxiety assaulted me, penetrating deep into my bones, making me feel as if my whole body was freezing over. I squeezed Andrew hard in terror. Frightful shrieked and flew at the window. "K-k-k-kak! Do something!" Startled, I reached for the phone in my pocket and dialed John at work. "You have to come home. Now!" Chapter 1. My son was kicked out of preschool because he kicked a visiting clown in the balls. His teacher called me at work and suggested we find another school that would better suit his needs. It would have been really funny, except for the fact that this wasn't the first time we'd been asked to find a more suitable place for our son. "He's non-compliant," his teacher said over the phone after sharing all the gory details about my child taking down a clown with one swift kick. "Andrew won't sit in circle time with the other students, and he's always wandering around the room. He covers his ears when I try to talk to him, and, well, I just can't have that." "What do you expect a 3-year-old boy to do? Maybe he doesn't like clowns," I asked. I was secretly impressed with Andrew. I hated clowns, too. I heard an exaggerated exhale on the other end of the line. "You need to get him right now. And, by the way, I think he might be coming down with something." At the time, I was working as an art director in a rapidly exploding dot-com company in downtown Seattle. It was fast-paced and I loved it, although I was putting in long hours each week. Without asking to leave, I waved my keys at my boss and skipped down the stairs, hoping to beat the rush hour traffic across Lake Washington. When I arrived at the school, Andrew stood rigid in the foyer with his coat zipped and his backpack at his feet. He clutched his plastic dinosaur, T-Rex, to his chest like he expected someone to wrestle him for it. His teacher waited for me to be within earshot before saying, "Here's your balloon, Andrew. It's a puppy." She handed him a pale blue twisty balloon of a wiener dog. Andrew dropped it on the floor and tore across the parking lot to our van. I said a curt goodbye and followed him, wanting to get out of there just as badly as he did. When I strapped him in the car seat, I noticed his lip had a tiny blister on it that wasn't there in the morning. "Does it hurt?" I asked. He shook his head no. During the 20-minute drive home, I studied Andrew in the rearview mirror. He was staring out the window, wide-eyed and unblinking, while rubbing a thumb across the bumpy hide of the plastic dinosaur. I noticed his usual shimmery red hair was stuck in sweaty points around the edge of his face, and that his cheeks had taken on a deep shade of pink. Maybe he was getting sick? Was that why he was so upset by the clown? I couldn't figure him out. It was so different from his baby sister Hannah, who at 3 months was already cooing and babbling with us like she had too many things to say and not enough time to say them. Andrew wasn't talking yet, but John and I had become so adept at reading his body language and gestures that it didn't seem to be a problem. "Sorry about the clown, buddy," I said into the rearview mirror. "We don't have to go back." Andrew raised T-Rex up to his face and pecked its oversized head at the back of my seat. I smiled back, knowing both he and T-Rex agreed. We drove the rest of the way in silence while I thought about the difference between my job as a designer and my job as a mother. Mothering required just as much creative energy as my art director position, but 10 times as much emotional energy. Being a mom meant that nothing was ever perfect, nothing was ever complete. There were no rewards for a job well done, no kudos wrapped up in a fat paycheck from a happy client. No, this new job of mine was most positively imperfect. So I tried to be the perfect parent, enrolling Andrew in the mommy and me socialization classes that were popular in the mid-90s, baby gymboree, kinder music, and special readings at the library. Unfortunately for me, the giant colorful parachute in the gym terrified him. The music hurt his ears, and although he loved stories, the library was too crowded. John and I were living in the era of Beanie Babies, Playmobil, Pokemon, and Barney the Dinosaur, a time when our home was a rubble of Legos and Little Tykes construction equipment, yet all Andrew wanted was a velveteen bear named Ben and a green plastic T-Rex dinosaur. During this time, I made frequent trips to the pediatrician, where my growing list of questions was never quite answered. Questions like, is it normal for babies to get sick all the time? Shouldn't he be walking by now? Why doesn't he talk yet? He won't look at me. Am I doing something wrong? Through all this, I became a germaphobe, one of those psycho, overprotective mothers who never let their children out of their sight without a packet of antibacterial wipes. I had become the kind of parent I loathed. I wondered, was that person still me? Turning up the hill towards our home on the east side of Seattle, more memories with Andrew passed through my mind. There were sweet memories of lazy summer afternoons at Puget Sound, dragging long ropes of kelp across the sand, shrieks of laughter and gap-toothed smiles from a 3-year-old scrambling down the beach after gulls, and Sunday drives to the mountains just to stomp our feet in the snow. I also remember Andrew in the pediatrician's office, fevered, frustrated, and angry. I pictured the doctor moving his stiff limbs one by one like a doll. I listened as he chattered, cooed, and tickled Andrew. I watched as Andrew stared, unblinking, at a fixed object across the room. Through all this, a seed of doubt was planted in the back of my mind. I wondered if I had done something wrong. "Did you know we were asked to find another preschool?" I told the pediatrician one afternoon during a well baby check. "I'm really sorry," he said with a genuine look of concern. Tears pricked at the back of my eyes. He was a kind man and had always been honest when answering my questions, even when he was just as puzzled as I was. "You're doing a great job, you know, but I think it's clear we both have some questions." His comment made me uneasy. After 3 years of questioning, I wasn't sure I wanted the answers anymore. It's absurd, I know, but I'd found something comforting, something reassuring even, in remaining naive. In the end, the pediatrician scribbled a name and phone number on a slip of paper. "I'd like Andrew to visit this neurologist. I think he can provide some answers." That night, I asked John what he thought of the doctor's observations. His concerns about Andrew's lack of responsiveness, stiff joints, and delayed speech. He shrugged and reached out to draw me in an embrace while reminding me that Andrew was only 3. "And don't forget," he said, "Andrew does smile and laugh, and he does talk to us. Just not with words yet." 2 months later, I walked into the neurologist's office, took one look at him, and considered backing out the door. He was a short, rectangular man with thick, heavy-lidded eyes that made him look like he hadn't slept in years, and his oversized ears refused to be hidden by an overgrown haircut. His mouth had forgotten how to smile, and by the expression on his face, it was clear he was painfully bored with his job. He motioned for us to sit, so I placed Andrew on the exam table and waited. He said nothing to me, nor did he engage with Andrew. Yet I noticed he was keenly aware of the way my son sat on the examination table, straight-backed, with arms and legs rigidly poking out in front of him. The neurologist paced the room while tapping on his watch face. Every so often he would stop, glance at the time, then pace again. I could only imagine what Andrew was thinking. Did he sense the doctor's disinterest like I did? "Aren't you going to examine him?" I asked after we'd been sitting there for 15 minutes. He responded by asking me a few questions about my health history, my pregnancy, and the delivery while continuing to watch Andrew. During the hour-long appointment, he never directly touched him, and at no time did Andrew look at or acknowledge the doctor's presence. "Okay, we're finished now," he said at the end of our allotted time. "But what do you think?" I asked, desperate for a quick and easy answer. He was halfway out the door before he said, "I'll have my secretary send you my notes in a few weeks." I was shocked and sure he had made all sorts of wrongful assumptions about my lack of parenting skills. Without a word, I pulled T-Rex from my purse and tucked him under Andrew's arm before snuggling him to my hip and walking through the door. That neurologist visit was weeks ago, and now, here I was, driving home in the middle of the day after my son had been kicked out of preschool, the last in a series of concerning things that I couldn't explain or fix. I wondered if maybe I was doing a terrible job at this smothering thing. As I pulled in the driveway, I glanced back at Andrew in his car seat. He waved T-Rex at me this time, and I smiled. "Hey, Andrew. Clowns suck, don't they?" I said. His eyes widened, and he let out a giggle before dropping T-Rex to the floor. Chapter 2. After the clown incident, John and I decided to keep Andrew home for a while. Between two grandmothers and a neighbor, we had 4 days a week covered, and I was able to convince my boss that I could work from home on the fifth day. We also applied for and joined a 26-week parenting class for spirited children at the University of Washington. I figured it would teach us everything we needed to know about raising a kid like Andrew. I was in serious need of an ego boost after becoming keenly aware of how different Andrew was from his peers. All the young mothers I knew used T. Barry Brazelton's book, Touchpoints, as a biblical reference on child-rearing. I devoured it and quickly realized we had failed all of the touchpoints. On the first day of class, we were separated into two groups, parent training and child play. Andrew was lured into a room with a colorful mat full of non-noise-making toys, six kids, and a bowl of goldfish crackers. John and I were led to a small conference room with six pairs of curious, eager, and uncomfortable parents. I sat next to another young mom, with a yellow pad and pen in my lap, ready to absorb and master the information that would solve all my problems. John was only marginally on board with my harebrained idea, so when he sat next to another irritated dad, they quickly struck up a conversation on the likelihood of the Seattle Mariners making it to the World Series. "Listen to what your child is saying," the instructor said as she began the first class. The mother next to me rolled her eyes and slumped down into her chair. "Yeah, but he doesn't talk, so that won't do me much good." I snorted, agreeing with her. Andrew didn't talk either. I was doing my best to be the perfect mom, but the truth was, I was terrified and more than a little frustrated. There were so many things I didn't understand. When I asked him to look me in the eye, he would turn red in the face and look away. When I wanted to hold his hand, he'd twist his fingers and slide out from my embrace. When I encouraged him to join other kids in play, he buried his head underneath my jacket or simply walked away. I wanted him to be normal. I wanted him to fit in, and I was sure I was doing something wrong. As the weeks progressed, I learned about the other preschoolers in our parenting class. One was a musician, his little hands tapping out a sophisticated rhythm on upturned pans from the kitchen set. His parents said he played at their piano every day, but they didn't know why. Another boy wore a construction paper hat and carried a plastic airplane above his head. He ran around the room flapping his free hand so he could fly. His parents said his grandpa was a pilot. My son wore a cape every day. I never thought much about it. One morning, halfway through our 26-week class, Andrew and I walked to the mailbox while 6-month-old Hannah napped. Andrew trotted ahead of me with his superhero cape billowing behind him while towing a red plastic wagon filled with his worldly treasures. On top of the jumble of treasures lay Ben, a little blue bear with embroidered eyes, pink velveteen cheeks, and a felt smiley-faced mouth. He was loved flat. Flat from being laid on, chewed on, rubbed, and hugged until his fabric frayed and the stuffing leaked out. Ben's shell went with us everywhere, to all the scary places like the grocery store, the park, and the pediatrician's office. Under Ben was T-Rex, a pirate named Joe, a giant 16-piece dinosaur puzzle, and a little red plastic lawnmower, for which I had a passing enmity. The weekend before, after a tug-of-war that ended in tears and shrieks of frustration, I had given up and allowed Andrew to bring the mower to my parents' house for lunch. My mother had thought his idea brilliant and had set it a place at the table. When we left, she invited the lawnmower to dine again. All hail Mom. When we reached the mailbox, I playfully scooped Andrew under my right arm, sausage style. "You do it like this," I said, showing him how to pull the mail out and slide it into his arms. He clenched his hands into a ball and screwed his eyes shut against my lighthearted play. Pieces of junk mail and a single fat envelope fell to the ground, scattering at our feet. I saw the letter was from the neurologist, and my heart lurched. I wasn't sure I wanted to read it just yet, so I stuffed it in the wagon and we walked back home. Hannah was still napping an hour later when I pulled a batch of cookies from the oven. I spied T-Rex's head grazing the edge of the kitchen counter, his plastic neck bouncing awkwardly towards the sink. T-Rex stopped to gaze at chocolate chip cookies cooling on a rack, a painted lizard eye studying the good eats. "Want a cookie?" I asked Andrew. T-Rex nodded. I noticed he was missing the rest of his body, scaly plastic legs, a distended belly, and an oversized tail. I suspected it was buried in a sea of toys at the far side of the room. I lifted a warm cookie with a spatula. "How about this one?" Andrew nodded, dropping the lizard's head and reaching his hands out in a "yes, please." "You like it?" I asked as he bit into the warm cookie. Andrew trotted out the front door without uttering a word. When Hannah and I caught up with him later, he was in the front yard picking the neighbor's raspberries that draped over our side of the fence. I sat Hannah down in my lap and watched him shove berries in his mouth, one after the other, without pausing to chew. For some reason, I couldn't shake the feeling of anxiety that always plagued me, even on relatively calm days like today. Andrew started to cough. "That's enough berries, Andrew," I said as he rammed two more into his mouth. As I led him away from the fence, he exploded in a fit of anger, shoving me with his red-stained hands before beginning to howl. I stood in my front yard feeling helpless, having no way of knowing what really set him off. I wanted to tell him that everything was okay and that I understood, but I didn't. Not really. I didn't know why I couldn't make him happy, and I didn't know why he kept getting sick. Out of desperation and exhaustion, I called my friend Diana. Diana was a speech pathologist and had been noticing his lack of speech, although she never directly said anything to me. Instead, I felt her eyes on him every time we were together. "He's just so angry," I admitted to her after witnessing Andrew chuck his lunch off the side of his high chair for the third time. "I don't know what's wrong. Would you please come over?" When I opened the door 20 minutes later, I was greeted by her infectious grin. "I have an idea," she said, walking straight into my kitchen. Andrew was bellowing in his high chair, covered in soggy Cheerios. T-Rex lay on the floor in a sticky milk bath. "You have any peanut butter?" she asked absently. I pointed to the bread drawer. Diana came back with a jar of creamy Jif and stood in front of Andrew. He wailed in protest just as she reached into his mouth with a fingerful of peanut butter. The crying stopped. Eyes wide in shock, he snorted, then tried pushing the sticky paste from the roof of his mouth with his tongue. "Lala, mama, papa," Diana exaggerated the sounds just inches from his face. He frowned, looking from Diana to me and back again. Intrigued, he poked a wet finger at Diana's mouth. Diana ran to my freezer and foraged for another treat. She held up popsicles for each of them. "Andrew, do you like grape?" Andrew took the popsicle and they both began again. Diana twirled the cold popsicle inside her mouth. "Mmm, isn't this pop yummy?" Andrew stared hard at Diana's mouth as she formed the words. "Mmm, pop," he said around the cold popsicle and peanut buttery goo. "Yes, pop," Diana jumped up, shouting. I was flabbergasted. I covered my mouth as a huge, silly grin spread across my face. Scooping Andrew out of the high chair, I smothered his face in sloppy kisses while dancing around my kitchen island. "Holy cow! You're brilliant!" I squealed to both my friend and son. I could tell by the way his face lit up, with a spark in his eye, that something fundamental had connected in his mind. He simply got it. For the first time, he realized what to do with his tongue, and now an entirely new world was open to him. That evening, when John came home from work, Hannah and I were watching Andrew put together his dinosaur puzzle on the playroom floor. John joined us, sliding Andrew onto his lap. "Da," Andrew said while casually pointing a finger at John. John's eyes widened.
That's right, Andrew. I'm Dad.
He caught my huge smile from across the room.
Oh my God, is this real?
He mouthed. I nodded and smiled back, thinking how long we had waited for just this moment. 3.5 years of worry evaporated as I sat there with my husband and our 2 kids. I could do this. Life had thrown us a few curveballs, but nothing we couldn't handle. Before bed, I emptied Andrew's wagon in search of Pirate Joe. The forgotten letter from the neurologist fell onto the floor, bringing back a strange feeling of foreboding. Unfolding the thick pages with something akin to dread, I read these words. Dyspraxia, tactile hypersensitivity, high muscle tone, rigidity, no eye contact. Most likely autistic. I reread the letter, word for word, as I allowed the truth to sink in. Waves of shock, fear, grief, disappointment, and even something like relief washed over me in a span of only a few minutes. At that time, what I knew about autism was Dustin Hoffman's portrayal of an autistic savant in the movie Rain Man. My son was not Rain Man, but he was mine, and he did seem to think he had superpowers. After all, he could talk to dinosaurs and leap major milestones in a single day. Chapter 3. 2 Septembers later, I sat idling in my red Toyota minivan in the empty grade school parking lot. No one knew I was inside, staring at a single sheet of paper that would define my son's academic life. For 18 months, I had been wrestling with and finally accepting the idea that Andrew needed to be in a special education program in order to learn. I scanned the paper for the label the neurologist had attached to my son. Asperger syndrome, high-functioning autism. An inky blue diagnostic code scrawled across the top of the form allowed the public school system to access federal funding for their special education department. Tucking the paper in my purse, I switched off the car, knowing that I would have to play their game, even if I didn't like it. I pulled down the car visor and caught a glimpse of my pale and anxious reflection. It immediately brought to mind my mother's familiar words. Put a smile on your face, a sparkle in your eyes, and for goodness sake, put on some lipstick. You look washed out. I grimaced at the thought and went rummaging through the bottom of my purse in search of something to make me appear more presentable. I wound my hair into a knot, strangling it with a rubber band, then quickly smeared a layer of coral lip gloss onto my pale lips. Are you ready? I spoke into the rearview mirror to 2-year-old Hannah. Hannah kicked the back of my seat with a repetitive tap, 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 and a wet thumb grazed her lips before being plugged back into her mouth. I dropped my keys and crawled into the back, huddling next to her car seat. She turned to me, eyeball to eyeball, her nose smashed to mine.
Good, Mommy,
she said, planting wet, gooey kisses on my cheeks. I unhooked the straps and drew her onto my lap, stroking her fine blonde hair, squeezing her soft body to mine, something Andrew would never allow. Minutes later, Hannah and I were walking together across the parking lot to her brother's new school, her ladybug rubber boots splatting in the puddles along the sidewalk.
Like this, Mommy,
Hannah hollered, stomping both feet into the deepest puddle. A spray of mud soaked the side of my jeans and dripped down the sleeve of my coat. Hannah's pleased grin reached up to me as I decided whether or not to be angry.
Do it,
she urged, pulling at my arm. I stomped in the puddle. A split second later, we were both covered in splotches of mud. A loud squeal of delight ripped through the air as Hannah broke free and ran down the sidewalk. I reached her as she stopped in front of the office. The door to the administration office had a construction paper sign on it that read, "Welcome, new kindergartners." School would not begin for 2 weeks yet, but the office staff was busy. The secretary at the front desk greeted me with an overly sweet smile, then a look of concern as she saw the streaks of mud on our faces. I dropped the neurologist's letter in her overflowing inbox, leaving before she could ask any questions. The first day of school set the standard for what would quickly become our daily routine. Andrew began his negotiations the moment he woke. What's for breakfast? Cheerios. Where's T-Rex? In bed where you left him. Where's Ben? Same place. Which pair of pants am I gonna wear? Your dinosaur pants. It was always the dinosaur pants with the labels cut out, and they were always on backwards. Andrew's teacher wanted him to sit in a reading circle, knees touching the other students, hands folded in his lap. But that was never going to happen. We had learned that in preschool. Each morning, Andrew moved his 2-foot square carpet to the far side of the room, sat on it cross-legged with T-Rex next to him, but not touching. Me? I liked school. A lot. I liked having those few precious hours free from the rigid confines of Andrew's world. And I was just getting into the swing of running my own part-time design business with a steady clientele. After lunch, when the school bus rumbled up the street, I would anxiously wait for a red-haired boy to scramble up the steps and burst through the door. I dreamed of Andrew telling me he had made a new friend and asking me if he could invite the friend to play. But it never happened. It was Hannah who filled in that gap without ever meaning to. She was his one-man fan club. One rainy November afternoon, as I was proofing brochure copy for a client, I caught sight of Hannah with her nose pressed to the living room window, her breath leaving fog circles on the glass. She raced to the door after spotting the school bus deposit Andrew down the street.
"Hello, brother,"
she squealed while yanking open the door. Andrew quickly handed her a green balloon, saying,
"Balloons scratch my brain."
A sudden memory of my 3-year-old dropping a twisty balloon of a wiener dog and tearing across the parking lot came to mind. Now, 3 years later, I figured out why he kicked the clown at preschool. Pulling off his backpack, Hannah took Andrew by the arm and led him to the kitchen where I was preparing lunch.
"It's macaroni and cheese and orange carrots and applesauce and gummy bears,"
she announced, pulling a hand from her pocket to show us both the gummies she had stored in there. Her continued babbling and silliness told me she was ready for a nap as soon as I could get her to finish lunch. While the kids sat happily in front of their gourmet lunch, one of my clients called in a panic. They begged me to edit some artwork and email a revised draft to them in 45 minutes for a newly scheduled conference call. I agreed to do it, knowing full well I would need every one of those minutes to complete the work. Part of that time would be spent battling the dial-up modem that took forever to transfer complicated graphic files. I added goldfish crackers to both kids' plates, turned Barney on the TV, and ran upstairs to the studio. Within minutes, I heard 2 sets of feet bounding up the stairs, and they both burst into the room.
"I want to play with the Play-Doh, Mama,"
Hannah said, reaching into the bottom drawer of my file cabinet. I watched as Andrew gathered colored pencils, markers, and paper I kept in my office for such occasions, then quarantined them to a table at the back of the room with their art supplies. 5 minutes later, a fight broke out. A quick glance at the clock showed I had less than 30 minutes left. Negotiations went poorly, so I quickly resorted to bribery. With little hands full of M&Ms, the dispute was settled. Eventually, I heard kind voices in the background and an offering to share. The TV clicked on in my bedroom down the hall, and the sound of cartoons floated into the studio. All was well. With only 3 minutes left, I entrusted my file to the staticky screech of the modem cramming my artwork into small, bite-sized pieces. Sensing that the room was too quiet, I got up to check on the kids.
"We're making art for you,"
Andrew said, looking up. He had removed the cutting board from my drafting table and placed it on the carpet in front of the TV. Paper and painting supplies were laid out for both Hannah and himself. Paper cups filled with poster paints were lined up like soldiers in front of each workstation. 4 empty paint bottles were piled up against the base of my bed, with most of the thick poster paint splattered on my white bedskirt. Hannah had obviously become bored with her paper and found the carpet a better medium with which to work. Broad blue, yellow, and green paint strokes arched across the carpet. My heart skipped a beat.
"This is just like you do, Mama,"
she said without breaking her concentration. I did exactly what my parenting lessons said not to do. I completely freaked out.
"What were you thinking?"
I shouted at my 3-year-old. Stunned, she stared at me.
"Why would you do this?"
I yelled some more, grabbing at a tipped-over paint bottle. Her lower lip quivered. Her mouth opened and then closed before she scrambled for her brushes and took off at a full run.
"I will wash them for you,"
she shouted. Blobs of sticky poster paint streaked its way down the hallway carpet. Andrew made a beeline for the door. "Stop!" I yelled at them both. Andrew froze in place, his brushes rolling from his hands, diving at angles into the carpet. I picked him up by the armpits and dropped him on the floor of his room before slamming the door. Seeing what happened to her brother, Hannah dropped everything and bolted to her room. I just stood there, wild with frustration, my feet firmly planted on a rainbow-colored carpet. Why was this so hard? I was trying to do everything right. I loved my job as much as I loved being a mother. I was contributing to the family with my small business, and I was staying at home to raise my kids. Isn't that what I was supposed to do? Hannah's little voice floated through the door.
"We're sorry, Mommy."
And then silence. I spent the next 90 minutes trying to clean the carpet and failed. 2 hours later, the carpet cleaner was at our house, and I was left with a bill for $350. Only then did I brave a call to John at work. I described in detail what had happened, adding in all the gory details and admonitions, wondering out loud why the kids just couldn't wait. "And I can still see some of the paint," I whined. For a moment, the line was quiet.
"Maybe we should have them paint the walls to match," he said, laughter in his voice.
I wasn't amused. I wanted to be mad at somebody other than myself, and he wasn't helping matters. Slumping down against the wall, I had a better view of my technicolor carpet. Maybe it was just a little bit funny. After all, I wasn't much older than Hannah when I started secretly painting on every blank surface I could find in my grandmother's basement. Maybe Hannah would choose to be an artist like me someday. Dinner that night was a quiet affair. Afterwards, I slunk up to my room, flipped open a book and tried to read, but too many questions swirled through my mind, making it impossible to concentrate. How did my friends make it look so easy? Karen next door had 7 kids, all in different sports. 2 of her middle schoolers were also in the local theater productions. Did she ever sleep? When did she have time to get pregnant anyway? The truth was, my work defined me. I enjoyed it, knew where I fit in, and knew how to speak the language. I was afraid to give up that feeling of belonging. But it was clear I couldn't keep up. My children needed all of me, not the back of a mom who was always facing away from them, ingrained in work that seemed so much more important. Something needed to change. After dinner, my mood improved a little. Andrew and T-Rex ventured across the soggy carpet into my room where I was hiding. I noticed he was flushed, but his sweet smile told me he was in a good mood.
"We were quiet," he explained to me, "and we painted pictures for your studio. I told Hannah you would be proud."
My autistic son, who only knew how to speak the truth as he saw it, was telling me something I was ashamed to hear. That maybe I needed to take a break and stop splitting myself in so many different directions. I pulled him onto my lap, hugging him as much as he would allow. "Mommy's going to take a break from working. It's kind of like a vacation. Do you understand?" I asked. Andrew nodded, wide-eyed and solemn.
"Then we can do art together."
He touched my mouth with T-Rex's head, an involuntary kiss, before sliding off my lap and padding back to his room. John crawled into bed much later that night, tugging and yanking the comforter in a loud, wordless statement of frustration. I played possum, lying as still as possible, eyes squeezed tightly shut. John bounced around a little more, smacked the feather pillow into shape, and eventually flung the sheets off and went in search of water. I still played possum. The next time he slipped into bed, he moved right up to the back of my head, hovered there a few long seconds before speaking into my right ear.
"I know you're not sleeping, so you can quit faking it."
I rolled onto my back, blocking his probing eyeballs with a hand. "You don't have to say it. I know I screwed up. This working full-time and trying to be a supermom thing isn't working out too well. But if I could just get the kids to cooperate..." He clamped a hand over my mouth and ran the other through his hair, making the long pieces stand up like a deranged artist serial killer. It kinda turned me on, the deranged part. I tugged at his hair, pushing it up on both sides into a mohawk.
Would you please quit trying to fix everything? Can't you just be? Life is more fun that way,
he said, biting at the tip of my nose. John's way of loving me is easy and fluid. He gives me all the space I need to be myself, happy and whole, space I rarely take. A tender and strong man, he cares for me in a way I rejected at first. It was too strange to have someone wrap me up in such a comfortable cocoon of care without strings attached. But the carpet, I said.
Who cares? Maybe this new mixed-media pastel carpet thing you have going will become a new trend.
I bit his fingers and pulled away before laughing.
Seriously, though, you might want to rethink about how much you're working right now,
he said, brushing stray hairs from my face and tucking them behind my ear.
It seems to stress you out as much as the kids.
I rolled onto my back and addressed the ceiling. I feel like everyone else can juggle work and kids. I just wish I could, too.
It's not forever. Maybe just scale it back a bit.
It was enticing. I was always running ragged and often had little patience for the kids. I turned towards John and slung a leg over his, seeking out the warm spot at the back of his knee to place my cold toes. He leaned in and kissed me.
You'll always be my crazy, type A, nutball artist. That's what I love best about you.
Then he rolled over and yanked the remaining covers to his side of the bed. We woke to a blood-curdling scream in the middle of the night. I was the first responder, levitating out of bed and streaking into the hallway to find out which room it was coming from. Andrew sat up in his bed, his hair gleaming like a burning bush, his entire body covered in sweat. He squeezed a hand over his belly.
It hurts all over,
he moaned when I reached his bed. I could tell by looking at him that his fever had spiked again. John knew the routine by now and was already halfway down the stairs to find Tylenol. I stripped him of his wet clothes and turned on the closet light. Even in the weak beam, I could see his lips were swollen, and I knew without a doubt that tiny ulcers lined the inside of his mouth. His body looked so frail, unlike the little boy that sat on my lap just hours before and told me he wanted to make me proud. Within a couple hours, John and I were able to get the fever down to a tolerable level, just long enough for the pediatric clinic to open in the morning. When I brought him in, the receptionist must have heard us coming around the corner because she called out for us to go down the hall into room 3, the soundproof one in the back. I swear it's not the flu, I said to the pediatrician as I set my whimpering son down on the bench. Would you please take another look?
He's in school now, right? Is there something going around?
No. I was afraid he would try to blame his frequent illnesses on school. I was sure it wasn't school. But if I remembered correctly, it was the third one since he began kindergarten in September. It seems like he gets sick like this every month. It's always the same, I said, more to myself than the pediatrician. For the next few minutes, he tended to Andrew. With gentle and slow movements and a soft voice, he lulled my nearly 6-year-old into a trance-like state. Why couldn't I do that? I thought. Sitting quietly on the stool in the corner, I watched as he peered into Andrew's eyes and ears, pausing to listen to his heartbeat and his breathing. I held my breath, waiting for a revelation. When one didn't come, I started getting twitchy. Something weird is going on. Look in his mouth, I blurted out. He peeled back Andrew's lip, revealing a row of blisters, some having already popped, forming lesions that looked like red-ringed cancer sores.
Maybe he has herpes, he suggested.
How in the world would he get herpes? I asked, clearly annoyed.
Let's test him to rule it out. And in the meantime, I think we just have a case of bad luck. Andrew might be one of those kids that catches every virus that comes by. I wouldn't worry about it.
I walked away from his office, feeling a little like I did when we saw the neurologist. Shocked, confused, and with an ever-growing list of questions. It seemed like every time I visited a doctor's office, I was talked out of my anxieties, like a hysterical, overprotective mother. Even if it was just a nasty virus, I couldn't shake the feeling that something was being overlooked. Weeks later, when Andrew was well, I asked him what his belly felt like that night. He drew 2 fingers across his abdomen in the shape of an X.
There were knives slicing me open, he said.
I knew he wasn't talking about a virus. Chapter 4.
I took a year-long hiatus from work before easing back into my design business. But this time, I used my graphic design skills as an interior designer. I started by providing clients with custom sewing for their homes, then quickly found myself in the middle of small remodel projects, a place where I could still keep my hands on all aspects of a design job. I thrived in my new role, but again, my home life was beginning to fray around the edges. In the end, John and I made a compromise. I would scale back my client base even more, and he would step in as needed, coming home from work a little early or taking the kids for long weekend outings so I could work. It worked beautifully, until we began to frequent the emergency room with Andrew's escalating fevers. Hannah found me in my studio one afternoon, straddling 6 yards of upholstery fabric while coaxing it inch by inch through my sewing machine.
"Andrew needs you, Mama,"
she called from the doorway. "For what?" I knew better than to question her, but I was eager to finish my project. I focused on long gathering threads, trimming them to the edge of the seam.
"He's feeling slow,"
she spoke in my ear. Hannah reached for my hand, tugging me down the back stairs and out into the yard where they were playing. Although she was only in kindergarten, her radar was highly tuned to her brother, and despite my continual protests, she had assumed the role of her brother's keeper. Andrew was sitting in a half-made fort in the backyard, pulling a sword fern crown onto his head when I arrived. Rust-colored pollen spores sprinkled his nose and covered his jacket. "What's up?" I asked. He pulled a lightsaber from the back of his shorts and pointed it at Hannah.
"Hannah, why do you always run to Mom?"
I looked at my daughter.
"Andrew is sick,"
she said, shrugging her shoulders.
"Am not."
Andrew poked the lightsaber at her face. Hannah grabbed it and ran. Usually, Andrew would have taken off after her, but this time he just stood there, watching her leave.
"I feel funny," he admitted.
"Funny how?"
"Just woozy."
I knew what that meant. We'd been doing this over and over for months now. Andrew would be perfectly fine. Then, within an hour or even less, he would begin to experience phantom pain. First, it was a pinprick in his mouth, like he had eaten something sharp that poked his skin. Within an hour, he would become weak as the fever rushed through his body. And then came the pain, the real pain that twisted in his gut, leaving him doubled over and breathless. I knew from experience that by the time John got home from work, Andrew would have tiny sores in his mouth, and we would be well into one of his 5, 6, or 7 day fever episodes. I called my client to say my sewing wouldn't be delivered for another week, and sat Andrew in the downstairs playroom with a Gatorade and 2 Tylenol. The plan was to get him to drink as much fluid and electrolytes as we could before the fever burned it out of him. Hannah sat next to her brother, playing a game of tease the cat with a laser pen. Charlie, our obese orange tabby cat, lurched at the red dot while occasionally bumping into walls, another distraction that would buy us some time. Somehow, Hannah had known this insidious monster was coming again. To this day, I don't know how she knew what was happening inside her brother before the rest of us were even aware. The only thing I knew for sure was the monster visited on a regular basis. At one point, I began a dedicated calendar and notebook just for Andrew's fevers. What I discovered was the fevers came precisely every 28 days, like a menstrual cycle, and they always peaked at 105 degrees. I also noted that the pattern never varied. It always started with a twinge in the mouth, followed by fever, pain, and nausea. During the worst episodes, when the pain became unbearable, we were admitted to the hospital. That night, we did avoid it, but on the next month and the month after that, we stayed for days while they hydrated Andrew and gave him his first taste of IV narcotics. During one visit, when we were asked to recount his health history yet again, I told the emergency room doctor about my discovery. He told me it was most likely a coincidence. It felt like a slap to the face, and I retreated with a burning sense of anger. Between episodes, when Andrew sprang from bed looking like any other...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.